Hello students, the last class I had spoken about was Wagner's theory of continental drift. That is this theory I had spoken about, and there are two theories in this: Davis' concept of cycle of erosion and Wagner's theory of continental drift. So now what we're going to study about is the continental, sorry, not the continental, the Davis concept of cycle of erosion. Now, William Morris Davis, an American geomorphologist. Now, what is a geomorphologist? Again, I will let you all know. Was the first geomorphologist to present a general theory of landform development. In fact, his theory is the outcome of a set of theories and models presented by him time to time. Complete cycle of river life in 1889, cyclic concepts of progressive development of erosional stream valleys. Basically, William Morris Davis was the first geomorphologist who evolved the concept of cycle of erosion in the late 19th century. His first attempt was a complete cycle of river life, 1889, in which he sought progressive development of erosional steam valley and finally emphasized on the sequential development, sequence-wise developing of landforms because of combined effect of endogenetic and exogenetic forces, which I have already taught you. In 1989, what was there? He propounded the concept of cycle of erosion with the guidance or with the help from the Darwin's model of evolution of organic life, in which growth takes place in an irreversible sequence which cannot be reversed with the passage of time. He gave the dictum that the landform is the product of structure, stage, and process. This dictum is known as trio of Davis. Now I repeat, we'll understand this. According to Davis, there are sequential changes in landforms through time, that is through youth, mature, and old stages. These are the three stages. And they are sequential changes which are directed towards well-defined end product development of peneplain. He postulated which concept? Geographical cycle. Cycle of what? Geographical cycle of erosion in 1899. To present, what was he going to present? A genetic classification and a systematic description of landform. He's defined it in this way. It is a period of time during which an uplifted landmass undergoes its transformation by the process of land sculpture, ending into low, featureless plain or peneplain. Davis called peneplain. Three factors were considered: structure, process, and time played an important role in the origin. Which were the three factors which played an important role? The structure, the process, and the time. And development of landforms of a particular place. Landscape is a function of structure, lithology, rock types. Lithology is rock sphere, folding, faulting process, agents of denudation. Denudation processes also I have told you all, where there it's wearing away of the earth's surface by the moving water, the ice, the wind, the waves. So, agents of denudation, including both weathering and erosion, running water in case of geographical cycle and time. What were the assumptions? That landforms are evolved products of the interaction of endogenetic, that is, diastrophic forces originating from within, and the external forces which are originating from the atmosphere. So the internal and the external forces both are acting or interacting upon one and other. The evolution of landform, according to Davis, the evolution of landform takes place because he's studying the evolution of landforms. It takes place in an orderly manner in such a way. We got to know about it that it's in sequence and it's in systematic order. So, in such a way that a systematic sequence of landform is developed through time in response to an environmental change. Streams erode their valleys. Over here, what is he saying? That the streams erode their valleys rapidly downward until the graded content condition is achieved. There is a short period rapid rate of upliftment in landmass. It may be pointed out that Davis also described this rapid rate of upliftment, students, slower rates and rapid rates if so desired. He says erosion does not start until the upliftment is complete. In other words, upliftment and erosion do not go hand in hand. So, according to Davis, upliftment and erosion do not go hand in hand. And it does not start until erosion doesn't start until the upliftment is complete. The cycle of erosion begins with the upliftment of land mass. Look at this. This picture will give you a brief idea of what Davis concept of cycle of erosion is talking about. Now, when I said I started off that he was the first geomorphologist, what does that mean? The term geomorphology, in the first chapter also, there were different terms which were used, different branches of geography which we studied. I shall repeat the same thing here. The term geomorphology refers to the scientific study of the morphology of the surface of the earth and the processes that operate on it. So, it is a scientific study of the surface of the earth and the processes that operate on it. Form and processes studied at a range of spatial and temporal scales. Now, here, before the pre-Davisian development came, what was it and what was it believed to be? So, over here, they are talking about the different ways it was perceived as before the Davisian development. Catastrophism. In this, what happens? It was viewed that the earth was dominated by religious beliefs, by religion beliefs. So there were a lot of religious beliefs through which the earth was dominated, and that was through catastrophism. It remained important until mid-19th century. So basically, it says that it remained important until mid-19th century. Scientific progress in surface earth science made by engineers and geologists. This was before this concept of cycle of erosion by Davis. There was uniformitarianism. What is this now? The present is the key to the past. Landforms have been formed by present day processes operating slowly over long periods. Newton, the theory of the earth. These are famous people who have given their own theories and philosophies. Lyell, principles of geology. Playfair, concept of hierarchy of streams. Glacial theory also was given. In 19th century, development of idea that the ice cover had been more extensive before when compared with today's conditions than that glaciers can shape landforms. Now the development of process-based work. Now before I say this, there is a trio. Davis defined the geographical cycle as the sequence of changes, as I said, which is an uplifted block has to go, which has to go undergo before it is reduced to base level. So the geographical cycle functions on three factors according to Davis. That's why it is called trios. So that is the structure, the process, and the time. Now in structure, when we Talk. Structure means lithological and structural characteristics of rocks like dip, strike, fault, and fracture. Process means agent of denudation, including weathering and erosion. Individually, I have spoken about these terms, whether it's denudation, weathering, I have repeated erosion, the fluvial action, wind action, and sea wave. Time required for landscape evolution. Over here, it is divided in three cycles of erosion, that's the youth, mature, and old stage that we'll be studying further. So what is the trio of Davis? Structure, process, and time. Now, when you talk about the development of process-based work before the Davisian this, there were three names attached to this: Powell, Dutton, Gilbert. They worked in Western USA. Little or no vegetation, active erosional processes allowed direct observations of landforms and related processes. Most of the initial process-based work was concerned with slope, form, and processes as well as fluvial processes. This process-oriented work did not immediately become important. Instead, beginning of 20th century marked is related to the influential work of Davis. Now, students, what I'm talking about here is basically the period before this concept was conceptualized and brought into picture. So that it is before Davis period. Now, actually, what and how has Davis' concept of erosion proceeded and how did it come across? It begins from here, the work of Davis. The cycle of erosion. It was end of 19th century. Sequential landform changes through time. There are progressive changes in geometry of landforms over geological time scales. Simply related to origin and evolution of landforms. Now, what do you understand by this? When I would like to explain the cycle of erosion, he has described his model of geographical cycle in a different way. The cycle of erosion is simple and it has a descriptive approach. Initially, nearly flat landscape uplifted. Period of tectonic stability. And then erosion proceeds after that. Landscape goes through a sequence of stages, each of them having distinctive characteristics. So the end result is peneplain, which is pronounced as peneplain. Now, what are the stages of, first of all, his assumptions? Let's understand the assumptions. The potential energy of landform initially uplifts IS, the dominant source of energy input to system, uniform lithology, considerable relief due to rapid uplift. Here, David's cycle model of cycle of erosion was built around four important assumptions. What was the first assumption? Landforms have been evolved through interaction between endogenetic and exogenetic forces. Endogenetic forces is diastrophism and exogenetic forces is weathering and erosion. Second assumption, transformation of landform takes place in sequential order through various time spans. Again, I repeat, first point was landforms have evolved due to the interaction. Landforms have evolved due to through the interaction between endogenetic and exogenetic. Next assumption is that transformation of landform takes place in sequential order through various time span, which he described as stage from uplifted land to featureless plain called aspen plain. So he described the stage from uplifted to the featureless plain called aspen plain. The upliftment of the land which is uplifted is fast and short time phenomena in his assumption. This upliftment is the source of potential energy for river erosion. So according to him, this upliftment is the source of potential energy for river erosion. Each stage of cycle of erosion was associated with declining potential energy as uplifted land is worn down. So as the uplifted land goes down, moves down, or is worn down, there is declining potential energy too. Erosion does not take place until the upliftment is completely stopped. In other words, upliftment and erosion do not occur simultaneously, as we read about that. Cycle of erosion continues. The fifth point, or the fifth assumption, according to Davis' concept, is the cycle of erosion continues until the river gets graded level. He incorporated the concept of graded condition, which is achieved near the mouth of the river. Now, the stages. What were the stages in the Davis model? The initial stage, vertical incision of drainage network, that is steep V-shaped valleys. Now, in his, there are three stages of erosion: youth stage, maturity stage, and old stage or final stage. So in the youth stage, what happens? That's the initial stage. Erosion started completely after completing the upliftment of land mass. Numerous streams are originated with the initiation of upliftment. When these streams are called consequent stream. Many tributaries are developed, and when they meet with the mainstream, they produce different types of patterns. In this stage, all the rivers are small and widely spaced. All the rivers are engaged in headward erosion and downcutting. Headward erosion causes for stream lengthening. So the first thing, what I would repeat the youth stage again. In the youth stage, what happens? Erosion starts after the completion of the upliftment of landforms, landmass. After this, there are numerous streams which are originating because of this upliftment. What are these streams called? They are called consequent streams. Through these consequent streams, there are many tributaries and they develop a pattern. In this stage, in the youth stage, all rivers are small and widely spaced. All the rivers are engaged in headward erosion and downcutting. Headward erosion causes stream lengthening. There are steep slopes and steep channels which are actively deepening their valleys. So these valleys become very deep and narrow. So this is called valley deepening. This process is called valley deepening. So the initial stage or the youth stage is called valley deepening. It is characterized by rapid down cutting and steep and narrow valley. Big boulders are basically carried by rivers, which help in valley incision through pothole drilling. Now, what are the characteristic features of youth stage? We need to understand what are the characteristic features of youth stage. What happens? They are very steep and they are narrow valleys. Gorges and canyons are formed. The absolute height remains constant. The relative height is continuously increasing. So the absolute height remains constant and the relative height is continuously increasing. There are steep V-shaped valleys. And the long profile of rivers is characterized by rapids and waterfalls. So in this youth stage, you can see these long profile of rivers are characterized by rapids and waterfalls. Now the next stage is the maturity stage. The drainage network ceases to increase, means it does not increase further. The topography is dominated by valley side slopes and flood plains. In this, what happens is the drainage system or the drainage network does not increase. The topography is dominated because of the valley side slopes. There are steep slopes and flood plains. So this is characterized by lateral erosion and integrated drainage system. The valley deepening is reduced. In this, valley deepening is reduced. Youth stage is called valley deepening stage. But in mature stage, what happens? This valley deepening reduces. So the absolute and relative relief also decreases. It turns into a wide valley due to lateral erosion. Mature stage is all related to lateral erosion. The graded conditions spread over larger area, and most of the tributaries are graded to base level of erosion. The third stage is the final stage or the old stage. Now, here in this final stage, what happens? There are broad floodplains. The lowering is rounded and it divides penny plantation, and 10 to 15 million years to develop. It takes 10 to 15 years to develop. So in old stage, what happens? This stage is characterized by almost total absence of downward erosion. In mature stage, which erosion was happening, students? Lateral erosion. And there was integrated drainage system. Valley deepening has reduced. They turn into wide valleys. But in last stage, there is downward erosion. But that does not mean that lateral erosion has stopped. It is still active. Thus, height of water divided decreases. The entire valley in the last stage or the final stage or the old stage, the entire valley becomes almost flat with concave valley side slopes. It becomes concave. This type of landscape is called peneplain. So the last stage is called peneplain. Sometimes hard rocks stand over the peneplain, which are resistant to erosions, and which are resistant to erosion, they are known as monad knocks. They are called monad knocks. So with this, what we come to know, how would you evaluate this concept of erosion? Davis cycle of erosion is simple to understand theoretically. He is the first who propounded this concept, that is cycle of erosion. It was applied, this cycle of erosion was applied in arid, glacial and karst geomorphological regions. But his model is criticized. Now his model is, there is criticism basically on the youth stage, pre-youth stage, because upliftment of lands takes at slow rate and continues for a long period. Different orogenies of the world indicated that they are completed during millions of the years. It is also questioned about the beginning of weathering and erosion. Weathering and erosion is not being spoken about. When did it come into picture? The process of this wearing away or denudation does not wait for the completion of the upliftment, but both go on side. Geomorphologists, people who study the surface of the earth, also have opposite views on the concept. So this is all the criticism and the evaluation of Davis concept. We are doing that to understand what criticism it has faced. So over here, what has happened is geomorphologists have opposite views on the concept of completion of the cycle. Endogenetic movement of climate change may take place during the period of cycle at any time. Completion of cycle, the process is caused due to rejuvenation of the river. Completion of the cycle rarely occurs in the world. So this was the second concept theory, or in this chapter there were two theories, as I said. So this was Davis's concept of cycle of erosion. Here, this is the criticism. In response to Davis's work, parallel, I repeat this. In response to Davis's work, parallel development of climatic geomorphology and structural geomorphology. Climatic geomorphology means that different climates produce different processes, which in turn produce different landforms, elaborations of morphoclimatic regions. Structural geomorphology, landforms are partly the result of structural movements within the Earth's crust. So this is also one kind of criticism. Climatic geomorphology, what were the problems? Use of crude climatic statistics and parameters. Few landforms restricted to just one morphoclimatic region. Same process but different frequencies and intensities. Regions are not sufficiently homogeneous. Now, students, when I started, we were on lesson 2. In lithosphere, I spoke about lithosphere. If we look at this diagram, we've covered everything we have spoken and discussed, and I have repeated n number of times certain concepts for you all to get it easy while learning certain concepts. So this is the end of the chapter or unit 2, lithosphere. In that we studied about lithosphere, the structure and composition of lithosphere, the different layers of lithosphere, that is the core, the mantle, the crust, the soil, the weathering. I explained to you all different types of weathering. What is physical weathering, chemical weathering, and biological weathering? I spoke to you all about minerals, how minerals are connected to rocks, because rocks are aggregates of minerals. I spoke to you all about different minerals, what are the plus points of minerals. Then we moved on to the earth. What does the earth mean? Try to study in detail, in depth, the characteristics of the earth structure. I covered earth's shape. We learnt about size of the earth, density of the earth. The radius of the earth was spoken about. There was another lecture which I specially kept on latitudes. I tried to make you all understand the basic concept of latitudes and longitudes. Why are latitudes called parallel of latitudes and why are longitudes called meridians? We discussed about prime meridian. Then I spoke to you all about the density. Again, the stratification of the interior of the earth, where I divided the three layers of the earth and their subdivisions, the core, the inner core, outer core, the mantle, the upper mantle and the lower mantle, the continental crust and the oceanic crust, all of that in detail. A small portion of composition of the earth's surface, how is it made? It composed of mainly iron, oxygen, silicon, and how is it in a way comprising of all these minerals at the continental crust and the oceanic crust. A short discussion of primary and secondary earthquake waves, the two waves I spoke about, the P waves and the S waves. Last but not the least, Bogner's theory of continental drift was discussed, where he brought about the idea that the Earth's continents were joined together, but they gradually moved apart over millions of years. And the last topic which I have covered in this chapter was Davis' concepts of cycle of erosion. With the concept, the trio of Davis, the assumptions we spoke about, I spoke to you all about the stages and what kind of criticism and evaluation is done over and on this concept of cycle of erosion.